So all of this should be very easy after the quiz, because the analysis will be very similar to what we did in the quiz problems. So as usual, I will terminate the output with a short circuit, an incremental short circuit. Which can be arranged by having a voltage source of the right value. Okay? Because always we found that if I excite this differentially, now I can't assume that this voltage is zero, okay, because the circuit is asymmetrical. Now it turns out that, which you will see from the solution to the sixth assignment, that under some conditions you can assume this voltage to be zero, and for that to be true you have to terminate the output in a short circuit. Okay. So that's why we always calculate the output current and the output impedance separately and combine the two to get the voltage gain. Okay. Otherwise also it can be calculated, but the algebra will be so messy that you will not be able to get any insight out of them. So what I want now is the increment I out of S by Vd of S. Okay. So first of all, I already said that you can assume Vx to be 0 under some conditions, and those conditions are true for this circuit. Okay. So what is this going to be? If we assume that Vx is 0, what is I out by Vd? What kind of transfer function will it have? Gm. No, that is at low frequencies. Over all frequencies, what's the transfer function? What order will it be? First order. How many poles and zeros will it have? One zero and one pole. It's, the answer is the same as what we calculated yesterday. Okay. Once we assume Vx to be zero, the circuit we are left with is this. Okay. Now the only thing that we could potentially add to what we analyzed yesterday, is the value of GDSs. Yesterday's analysis assumed no GDS. Okay. I mean GDS equal to zero. If GDS equals 0, even in a differential pair, Vx exactly equals 0. So we can add GDS also to this. So here we will have a conductance of Gm, P, and GDS P, and what will be the capacitance here from this node to ground? So it will be CdBP plus CdBN plus 2 times CgSP. Okay. It's the drain to bulk capacitance of this transistor, that of this transistor, and the gate source capacitance of these two transistors. We'll neglect CgD in all our analysis. And we have a controlled source, which is GmN times Vd by 2, and we have this conductance of the NMOS transistor also. Okay. So if this is V2, this is GMP times V2, and the conductance of the PMOS Here we have GM and the conductance of the NMOS. Okay. Mainly because it gives you messy expressions. In this case, if you drive it with an ideal voltage source, it also doesn't have any effect. Okay. Huh? Yeah, that's true. So we'll not analyze it like this now. So we'll see. We already analyzed the common source amplifier with CGD and everything. Okay. So in this particular case, we'll not do that. Mainly because the algebra gets very messy and doesn't again add to much. Okay. May not be an extra pole also, because if it is across two capacitors, like in a common source amplifier, it doesn't increase the number of poles. It only modifies the location. Okay. So we'll make some approximations, because if you try to calculate analytically the entire transfer function, it becomes so messy. Okay. So we'll keep making approximations, because we have to get some answer which will lead us to a way to design the circuit. Okay. So this is Iout. What is the effect of these two conductances? Nothing, because they are shorted. Okay. So they don't have any effects. This one and this one. So what is the DC gain? Iout by Vd. What is the value of the transfer function at DC? GMN. And what's the location of the pole? It's the sum of all these conductances. Sum of three conductances divided by this capacitance. Okay. And what's the location of the zero? Half of this. What is the location of the zero? Twice this. See, at very high frequencies, you have to get half the signal. Okay. So the pole has to come before the zero. Okay. At low frequencies, you get certain transconductance. At very high frequencies, you get it only from M2. The contribution of M1 is made negligible by the parasitic capacitance here. So this is the transfer function Iout by Vd. I mean, there are several approximations there already, like neglecting CGD, but we have to do that to get any kind of analytical answer at all. Okay. Of course, for full characterization, you resort to simulations. This is okay. No, the zero comes because you have two paths to the output. Generally, when you have multiple paths adding at the output, you will have zeros. Okay. So in this case, it's like you take the controlled current GMN times Vd by 2 and pass it through two paths, one of which is a low pass filter. Okay. So, and then you add the two. First of all, if you calculate the transfer function, you will see that this is okay, which is now where the zero is in relation to the pole depends on the relative weighting of the two factors. In this case, I have chosen equal weight, but I can do, let's say, alpha 1, alpha 2, and get the zero anywhere I want. Okay. The other way to think about it is, you have at low frequencies, you have the signal adding up to give you twice the input signal. Okay. And at high frequencies, this is not there. So, you will get half. Okay, at very high frequencies, you will get only this much. So, the transfer function goes from being like this to being like this. Okay, if this is some A naught, this is A naught minus 6 dB. Okay, so it has to go from there to there. So, there has to be a pole here and a zero here. No, I did not. What? Oh, you mean, yeah, that's correct. So, we also evaluated with GDS, right? You will get some current division. Yeah. Why not? DC gain is, okay, GMN divided by this one, right? Yeah. Okay. So, what is the issue? Yeah, that's what I told you that we approximated, right? So, even before we evaluated this, but then for most expressions we do approximate it. And even in this case, to calculate the pole, it's quite alright to neglect these two terms and say it is GMP divided by the parasitic capacitance, because it does overwhelmingly dominate over the others. Okay. Yeah, that we have to see. See again, so the next thing we have to calculate is, we have the transadmittance, then we have to calculate the output impedance. Okay. Now, the calculation of output impedance is very complicated if you put in all the possible parasitic capacitors and use all of the conductances. Okay. So, again, here we make, we just estimate some impedance based on what we can calculate, really, not so much on what is there. So, if you put in all these capacitance, there will be capacitance here, there will be capacitance here, okay, and there will be parasitic conductances here and here, of course, also here and in this place, okay. So, you can try and calculate all of it, and it certainly can be calculated, but we won't do that here. Okay. We will mainly look at what the output resistance is at DC, that we know. What is the output resistance? The output conductance is GDSP plus GDSN. Okay. And then we just look at what capacitance we have from the output node. Okay. And what is that? So, it is just the CdB of the NMOS transistor. So, you have to resort to these approximations to make any sense of the result at all. Now, you can try and estimate what happens because of this capacitance. Okay. So, let us say I remove everything else. What is the effect of this capacitance? I apply some V test here. What is the current that goes here and what is the current that goes here? This we calculated. Now there are no capacitances. Let's talk about the case of no capacitances. What is the impedance looking up? What is the impedance looking down? Huh? What's that? What is this? We calculated this last week. This is GDSN by 2 and this is GDSP plus GDSN by 2. Okay. Now I have a capacitance here. So what is it going to be? Let's say when this capacitance is dominant. Is the question clear? I am trying to just estimate the effect on one part of the output impedance because of one particular capacitor. Okay, because I don't want to do it for everything. I mean, I don't want to get a single large expression which contains everything because then I'll not be able to figure out what's going on. Okay. So what's the effect of this capacitance? Cp? What do you think it's going to be? So again, you look at what happens to the impedance looking down and impedance looking up at very high frequencies. What's that? So at very high frequencies, what happens is you have this capacitance shorting the source of this to ground. Okay, so looking down you will have GDSN. Okay, and none of that will get reflected because of feedback. Okay, so this will become just GDSP. So there will be some poles and zeros, but in the end also it will come to the same value. Okay, so again you can evaluate it and see that it doesn't have that much of an effect. And what is the frequency at which, what is the critical frequency of interest here? When will it start changing from GDSN by 2? Huh? Why GMN plus GMP? Yeah, looking in from here is what? What is the impedance looking in here? GMN, 1 by GMN, that's all. It's a common gate amplifier which is terminated in a relatively low impedance. Okay. So the conductance looking in here is GMN. Okay. So I can try and write the whole expression in some approximate sense. So at low frequencies, it will be GDSN by 2, and at omega much greater than GMN by Cp, it will be of the order of GDSN. Okay. Twice GMN? Why? No, because we are looking into only this part. Okay. No, right now I am only looking at this part just to see how much current goes up. Okay. So, and this is also a relatively high frequency. Okay, so we are somewhat justified in neglecting it. At least we will keep all of these frequencies beyond the unity gain frequency. Okay. Compared to, okay, maybe I should calculate the, what will be the, if I open circuit the output, what will be the gain? I mean, gain as a function of frequency. So here again I'll approximate, I'll rather what I'll do is this. P1, okay. And P1 is approximately GMP by CDVP plus CDBN plus 2 times CGSP, where I have neglected the GDSS. Okay. So what is the gain going to be? What is the gain of the amplifier as a function of frequency if I open circuit the output? Ym by y out. Okay. So this again is an approximation because I have neglected all other parasitic capacitances except the ones that appear directly at the output. So Ym by y out will be Gmn by GDSP plus GDSN. So this is the DC transfer function. 1 plus S by Z1, 1 plus S by P1. Okay. So maybe I should denote this P2 for, I'll explain why in a moment. I'll denote this one P2. Okay. And Z1 is at 2 times P2. And where is the other pole? It's the ratio of this conductance to this capacitance. Okay. And I'll call this P1. I mean, I want P1 to be the dominant pole. That's why I changed the notation. So clearly compared to P1, P2, Z1, all of these things are very high. Okay? And what happens if I have certain load capacitance CL to the differential pair? What will happen to all of these quantities? So it will only appear here. Okay? In addition to these two, I will have to add CL as well. Okay. So if I have some explicit load, then that pole becomes, that pole moves to even an even lower frequency. So the approximations we made are valid. Okay. And what's the unity gain frequency of this op-amp? We have finished all of the small signal analysis. Okay. We have to make a number of approximations along the way so that we get some answer that we can look at and figure out something. So the main features are that the DC gain is similar to that of a common source amplifier. You get a pole zero pair. This is because of the two path structure. Okay. We have a differential input but a single-ended output. So one side of the differential input goes to the output through a different path than the other side. Okay. Because of this asymmetry, you will get a zero and a pole. And also at the output, you get a dominant pole. Output resistance is rather high and you have some output capacitance. The combination of the two gives you a dominant pole. Okay. So what's the unity gain frequency of this op-amp? So, if it is predominantly a first order type of behavior, which we expect it to be, because P1 is much lower than P2 and Z1, etc., it is the product of DC gain and the dominant pole. Okay? This we have evaluated several times. So, the unity gain frequency is approximately Gmn by the parasitic capacitances at the output plus the load capacitance. Basically, the total capacitance that you see at the output. And we knew this was the answer, right? If you drive a capacitance with a transconductance, you will get the unity gain frequency to be the ratio of the transconductance to the capacitance. Okay. So this should enable you to design a single stage op amp for a given unity gain frequency. There are other specifications also. We will come to that. So how will you increase the unity gain frequency? Yeah, so you have to increase GMN. So you have only two things here, right? And CL, I am assuming, is a specification that's given to you. It's not really under your control. Okay, as far as designing this op amp is concerned, it's not under your control. So you have to increase GMN to increase the unity gain frequency. So how will you do that? You can either increase size or increase current. Okay, we will see the effect of each of them, because we will have other specifications also. We will see what the effect will be soon. Okay. So any questions on the small signal high frequency analysis of the differential pair? The main thing to note is that whenever you have this differential to single ended conversion with a current mirror or in any other way, you will have two paths to the output, okay, with different frequency limitations, which tends to give you a zero. So if there are no further questions, we can go on to the next part, which is to analyze the differential pair for noise and mismatch. Okay. Yeah. Now all of them will have some effect. Okay. The question is whether CGD of this transistor will have any effect. Yeah, it does. Right. So the high frequency output impedance will be different, in that at very high frequencies, if this becomes a short. Okay. If this is a short, this will be like having feedback around this transistor. So the high frequency output impedance will be different. Okay. But for this to become a short, essentially the reactance of this capacitance has to be much smaller than the impedance you see on the other side, which is 1 over GM. Okay. So again, that happens at a very high frequency. Is this clear? Anything else? So we would like to calculate the output noise current and the input referred noise voltage of the transconductor. Okay, and we will do this only at DC, and at high frequencies we can do it by simulation. We can also calculate it based on some approximations. Okay. But all of the essential features can be figured out by analyzing it at DC. So this is the bias at the output. Okay. Now what we want to find out is, we have zero increments at the input. Okay, both of them are at VCM, and we have 5 transistors, so we model the noise of each transistor, find out the output current, and make a table of the output current from all of the noise currents of the transistors. Then we add up all the spectral densities, usual procedure. Okay. So I will define Iout like this, flowing out. Okay. So I first model the noise of M0. which can be modeled using a noise current source from drain to source. What is I out because of I0, IN0? What is the value of I out because of IN0? What is it? How will you figure it out? So essentially this is like having a small signal increment of IN0 at this point. Now how do you figure out how much of it comes to the output? Again, what is the impedance looking up here? So the circuit is not fully symmetrical. If it's fully symmetrical, you can say half of it goes here, half of it goes there. But still, it's almost symmetrical. Okay? What is the impedance looking up here? 1 by GMN. And what is it looking up here? What is it? Why? Yeah. So what is the output input? It's 1 by GMN again, right? It's a common gate amplifier terminated by a low impedance. Okay. So how will INO split into these two? Equally, right? Whatever it is, it will go INO by 2, INO by 2. Okay. And this INO by 2 from the left side gets mirrored through the mirror M3, M4 and appears here. Okay. And nothing flows to the output. So the effect of tail current appears as a common mode input. It really doesn't appear as a differential input and doesn't appear in the output either. So the contribution of M0 is 0. Okay. Now, when you have the differential pair properly balanced in the quiescent condition, that is the two gate voltages are the same, that means that equal bias currents are flowing through M1 and M2. Okay? That is the key here. When equal bias currents are flowing, their transconductances are the same. So it will divide equally. Okay? It's if the differential pair is unbalanced, that's not necessarily the case. Is it okay? Now I have a noise source because of the transistor M1. How will you analyze this? What's the output current I out because of IN1? Huh? Yeah. So what is it? What is the answer? IN1. Did we do this for the differential pair? I think we did this when we were discussing the common gate amplifier. No, it's not, right? It's what will you write as differential and common mode input? Yeah, but the circuit is not symmetrical. Okay. So in fact, when we make fully differential circuits, it will be a lot easier. We can just analyze the half circuit and double the answer. But anyway, let's figure it out from first principles, even if we have done it before and forgotten already. How will you analyze this? Is that so? So he says you split the current source. So this is a good technique to use in this case. Okay. And both of them are exactly the same current, that you have to keep track of. Okay. So what happens now? Okay. The answer is the bottom source contributes nothing and the top one will contribute all of it to the output. Is that correct? What? So one of the answers is that the lower, this source doesn't contribute to the output at all and this one contributes everything. Is that correct? Why? So actually if you have, see, let's say you analyze this with completely different sources. Let's say this was IA and IB. What will happen? What is the output current? IA. So that is true. It is correct that, I mean, of course, in this case, both currents are exactly the same. So you can either think of one of them providing half and the other one providing half, or both of them, I mean, the lower one not providing anything. But if you do analyze it with different current sources, you will see that IB will not contribute anything to the output. Okay? Because IB is this current, okay, which is analogous to the noise current of M0. So it will split into half in M1 and M2, and none of it, no fraction of it will flow into Iout. Okay? Yeah, that's correct. But what will happen to the other one? So anyway, let me write out the currents in all the transistors. So the other interpretation also kind of makes sense if you think about it. So we have this. This is IN1. Okay. Now this will cause a current IN1 in this transistor, okay, because looking down it has a higher impedance than looking up, and you have also have this IN1 here, okay, so this will contribute IN1 by 2 this way and IN1 by 2 this way, okay, so what is the total current in M3? So IN1 minus IN1 by 2. Okay, so the net current flowing through M3 is still IN1 by 2. So if you give the other answer, it's also kind of right, isn't it? You say that half of it goes there. It's only when you analyze it with independent sources that you see which is going where. Okay, so the net current in the net current in M3 is IN1 by 2 flowing downwards. Okay. So whatever it flows in M4 is IN1 by 2 this way. Okay. So these two will add together to give you IN1. So the answer is correct. It is like all the current of M1, all the noise current of M1 goes to the output. But you can think of it as being split also. Yeah. If you neglect
the GDS,
yeah.
Isn't the same as the one we
analyzed yesterday? No, not really. Because yesterday we had this voltage to be 0.
Yeah, but here also this voltage is going to be 0 plus. Let's say that here the incremental output is 0.
Incremental?
Yeah,
so the incremental output here is 0. Okay, what about the common source node? This is not zero. No, no, no. Oh, I want you to be very careful about this. What I said was, if I have VCM plus VD by 2, VCM minus VD by 2, and you have the output terminated by a short circuit, this voltage is at 0, under symmetrical excitation. If you have noise current only on one side, that voltage is not 0. Okay. In fact, if this voltage is 0, right, is it possible that in our current analysis, with the noise connected to, I mean, with the noise of M1 being analyzed, this voltage is 0? Is it possible or? What happens if this voltage is 0? There is no incremental current through M2, right? M2 will not have any incremental current, and M1 also will not have any incremental current, because the gate source increment is 0, right? So that's not possible. In fact, you need to have an increment there for the analysis to be consistent. Okay, so now that the method is clear, it should be quite easy to do the rest. What happens with this? This is IN2. What is Iout? How do you relate Iout to IN2? It will turn out to be minus IN2. Okay. Again, you can split this into two, ground the midpoint and then see. Okay. So this IN2 will get split to IN2 by 2 here. And IN2 by 2 this way. Okay. And which appears here and here also. Okay. And Iout is nothing but the sum of all the currents coming into this node, which is minus IN. So these two will cancel each other and you will have IN2, minus IN2. Okay. So if you inject the bottom line is, if you inject a current at the tail node or the source coupled node, it will not appear at the output. Okay. Assuming the differential pair is biased in a balanced way. Okay, and we have noise current from noise current in M3, let's say IN3. What is its contribution to the output? Minus IN3, plus IN3, right? So if we want to keep the sign, this is flowing out of the drain here. And this will mirror the same current. Okay. This is IN3. So in this case, you don't need much analysis. In fact, you can neglect the bottom part of the circuit. And what about IN4? What's the result of IN4 on the output? Minus IN4. Okay. So the total current will be IN1 minus IN2 plus IN3 minus IN4. But again, we are interested in the spectral density of the output current, which is the sum of spectral densities of noise currents of all four transistors. Okay. So exactly the same answer we got for the problem in the quiz, because the tail current happens not to contribute anything. Okay. So you can use that result also to gauge the effect of any disturbance that you inject to this node. Okay. But of course, the condition should be kept in mind that the differential pair has to be biased in a balanced condition. Okay. So the output noise spectral density is 1/16 kT. GMN plus GMP. Once you are fluent with this analysis, the analysis of all other op-amps will become very easy because they are all the same, derivatives of the same topology. Okay. And what is the input referred noise current? Again, let's consider only DC. We don't have to worry about high frequencies. What is the transconductance? GMN. So we divide the output spectral density by GMN square and we get this. So the second term here is the noise contribution of the load. Okay. So as I explained yesterday, if you make a transconductance at a given unity gain frequency, so let's say you are given a load capacitance and you are asked to make a certain unity gain frequency. Okay, make an op-amp with a certain unity gain frequency. So what do you have to do? GMN by CL is omega U. So you have to realize a certain amount of GM. So that will give you this much noise, okay, or in terms of input referred voltage, this much. So that's the absolute minimum you can get. Okay. Once you make a GM, you will have that much noise. Now depending on how you design the load, you will have some extra. Okay. Contribution of the active load is this one. Is it okay? So the noise on a differential pair can be modeled by an input voltage source, a voltage source in series with the input of the transconductor, and the spectral density of that voltage source will be this. It's good enough to approximate it by this without worrying about the frequency limitations inside. Okay? Because as I discussed earlier, the pole, because of this node, is likely to appear beyond the unity gain frequency, and so generally it's not of much interest. Okay. Now, up to this part, in fact up to this, we have not assumed that it is thermal noise, it is any noise. Okay. So if you want to calculate the flicker noise density, you simply calculate the flicker noise density of each transistor and you add up everything. Okay. So that's all that's there to it. Any questions on the noise analysis? You also see that if you want to reduce the input referred noise, you have to increase the transconductance, okay, which again comes at the cost of current or area. So let's quickly do a couple of things about mismatch if there are no further questions. Now, mismatch again can be analyzed in exactly the same way, and typically the noise analysis and mismatch analysis go together because they are like small disturbances around the operating point in each transistor. Okay. Now before we go into the analysis, I'll assume that the mismatch that is given to you Okay, you are given some AVT. Okay. And AVT by square root of WL is the mismatch between two identical transistors of WL. Before I had mentioned that you can, I mean, depending on who gives you the number, it could be the mismatch in each transistor compared to the average value, or mismatch between two transistors, each of which is different from the, could be different from the average. Okay, we'll assume that in our case, AVT is given such that this quantity is the mismatch between two transistors, two supposedly identical transistors, each of aspect ratio W by L. Okay. So, the two numbers are not, I mean, independent of each other, obviously, like they are related by square root of 2, right. So, let us also assume that this comes from a current mirror, okay, which is biased at some I naught. I am assuming a 1:1 current mirror. So, what is the effect of VT mismatch in M0? When I say M0, I mean between M0 and its pair. How will you analyze the effect of mismatch? We have two mismatches. One is the VT mismatch, the other is the current factor mismatch. Okay. Now, VT mismatch can be modeled as a voltage in series with gate source. Okay. So, that is how we will model it here. It can be in either direction. So, this is delta Vt. Okay. So, this is anyway the delta Vt between these two transistors. Okay. So, what is the effect of this? What is the effect? How will it modify anything? I mean, does it change anything in the circuit? It will change the current. So, it is like having, instead of this voltage increment, it is like having a current increment here. And what is the amount of current increment? Gm 0 times delta Vt 0. Okay. Now, we have already analyzed it for noise. Any current source from this point to ground will not appear as Iout. Okay. So, what about current factor mismatch in these two transistors? It will have the same effect. How will you model the current factor mismatch? How will we model the current factor mismatch between two transistors? What is that? So, the current factor mismatch means that this current, instead of being I naught, it will be I naught times delta beta by beta. I mean, 1 plus delta beta by beta. So, I will model it with a current source of this value. Okay. So, if I am interested in the current factor mismatch between a pair of nominally identical transistors, what I can do is I can place a current source across one of them of value I naught delta beta by beta. Okay. Is this clear? I have two of them, so I want to calculate the mismatch between them. So, I can put all of the mismatch into one of them, or I can put half into each in opposite direction. Both will give you the same answer. Let's stop here. You can figure out what happens to the rest of the transistors. Okay. And the answers will be very similar to what you get for noise.